science, technology, engineering, and math careers. Astrid has been a professor at Northwest College for the last 21 years and is the chair of the Earth Science.
Physical sciences
division of the college. She has extensive experience not only in teaching but also in petroleum engineering and geology. And I think she will give us some really good things to think about today. So please welcome Astrid.
Well, thank you. And thank you all for being here. There's a lot of familiar faces, and some of my former students are here. So this is, and some of their children. So this is really exciting stuff. So I'm really happy to be here, and I appreciate you you attending today. If you can't hear me, just give me a little signal and I will speak up. And my presentation is about 15 to 20 minutes long. So if you have any questions, please feel free to ask and we'll go from there. So the name of my presentation, I'm Not Good at Math, She Said, is actually from one of my colleagues who's an English professor who's a little more clever with the written word than me. But having said that, beginning. Let me tell you my greatest frustration as an engineer. Whenever I meet another person and they ask, what do you do? And I say, I'm an engineer. I teach engineering science and math. If that person is a woman, she will often say, oh, I am not good at math. I hate math. I really can't do math at all. And I wonder, whatever happened to her to make her believe that about herself? The flip side of this is, if a person were to say, I hate reading, I can barely read, I'm practically illiterate, we would assume that that person is not very educated and maybe is not very smart. As a society, we have parameters for what we expect from educated people, which includes literacy. And yet, we don't hold this as a value for math, at least not for women. And that's what I'm here to talk about today. This is what really got my attention when I was a kid growing up in Butte, America. Mission Control, NASA, the Apollo missions. This looked so exciting to me. Everybody was like running around, drinking coffee, smoking cigarettes, ripping off pieces of paper from the dot matrix printer, making split-second decisions. I just wanted to be in that room. And I noticed so much about that room. But somehow I missed the fact that everybody in that room was a man. This is a more recent picture of Mission Control. Aside from the new uniform of blue polo shirts and jeans, the major difference I see is gender diversity. All of these people are scientists. NASA didn't blow up or go under when women began working at Mission Control. The new group continues to do the same excellent work as the group from the 1960s. So here's my first point. Men make good engineers, and so do women. But here I am talking about NASA and science, and what does that have to do with math? People who aren't nuts about math often dismiss its importance. After all, these folks will tell you that they've gotten along all these years without ever needing to solve a quadratic equation or integrating, well, anything, right? But the fact that you haven't needed math doesn't mean that using math wouldn't make your life richer. Richard Feynman was a theoretical physicist who did work in the field of quantum mechanics and particle physics. And what he says here means that from everyday things, like water running downhill, to sophisticated things like orbital mechanics, all of these things are described and predicted using math. And the study of science, technology, engineering, and math are so interrelated that the four are referred to by one acronym, STEM. So math is the language of the natural universe. To really understand how the universe works, you have to speak math. And as if unlocking the mysteries of the universe isn't enough, there's another reason to study STEM. We don't have enough people doing it. Right now, the US engineers and scientists of all kinds. The fact that we are selectively not educating women means that we're missing out on at least half of the good engineers this country has to offer. If we had more people studying math, we could generate more electrical power, we could grow better crops, we could make more clean water, we could update the infrastructure, we could invent new things that we haven't even heard of, and make life better for everyone. So at this point I always say, loud audible sigh. Not true. The fact is, today girls are doing as well as boys in math by most measures. For example, in high school, girls' average performance and participation in math and science has improved over time and in some cases has surpassed that of boys. This graph shows the average GPA in math and science for U.S. high school students by gender between 1990 and 2005. Girls are green and boys are purple. As you can see, over time all students have earned higher GPAs because both lines are going up. You can also see that girls have had higher GPAs in math and science than boys over this entire time range. This graph shows the average number of high school credits earned in math and science by gender, once again between 1990 and 2005. And again, girls are green and boys are purple. As you can see, over time all students, both boys and girls, are taking more math and science credits because both lines are going up. And girls now earn more credits in math and science than boys do, and they have been since 1992. But despite this overall positive trend in high school, the transition from high school to college is a critical time for young women in STEM. Women are less likely than men to declare a STEM major. In 2006, only about 15% of first-year female college students, compared to more than 25% of first-year male college students, planned to declare a STEM major. And if we take biological and agricultural sciences out of the numbers, it drops to only 5% of incoming freshman women. So if it's not ability, why do boys pursue math and girls don't? Well, the research indicates that women think that they're worse at math than they are, and that they also think they're worse at math than men. And neither one of those things is true. If you look at this list of the characteristics of a good scientist, none of these items is terribly masculine or feminine. There's a movie out now called Hidden Figures that you may have seen. The movie and the book it's based on are about NASA in the 1950s and 1960s. And the African-American women who worked there as mathematicians and scientists. Did any of you wonder why all these women were walking around with math degrees that long ago? Well, it turns out that most of these women had been educated at historically black colleges to teach at segregated schools in the American South. So even then we knew that women could do math. Pictured here is Katherine Johnson, the central character of Hidden Figures. She was a prodigy, graduating from high school at age 14, and from West Virginia State College, a historically black college, summa cum laude at the age of 18, with degrees in mathematics and French. She then began her first career as a teacher at a segregated public school in Virginia. The year was 1937, a full 16 years before she began her career at NASA. Years ago, I taught the algebra sequence to a wide array of students in a self-paced lab. If students did poorly on an exam, I met with them individually to go over tests. And you know they did not like that very much, by the way. But I was struck by how often I could predict their response based on their gender and their nationality. I think this anecdotal information can tell us something about the problem we're discussing today. also found repeatedly something called stereotype threat that has a negative effect on girls' performance in math tests. It works like this. In the experiment, researchers give a math test to two groups of male and females who have similar math abilities. One group of men and women of similar abilities is told that men do better on the test than women. The other group is told that men and women do the same. Well, it turns out over and over again, if the group is told that men do better, the women do worse than they do if they're not told that men do better. This result has been shown over and over again, and it's also interesting to note that the threat, no threat scenario has no measurable effect on boys' performance, only the girls'. So while it's true that talent is real, it's not true that you must be talented to do math. And whether you are talented or not, you have to practice. In the book Grit, which I recommend everybody reading, author Angela Duckworth says that as human beings, we love a natural. Talent seems magic and glamorous, whereas practice and hard work are more pedestrian. But we need to emphasize the possibility of growth, of developing ability, rather than viewing ability as something inherent and permanent. We need to emphasize the ability, we need to emphasize that ability is something you do rather than something that you are. Carolyn Turk is a mechanical engineer in Maryland. And as she points out, everybody has to work hard to master science. Jean Kranz purportedly said, failure is not an option. But maybe we could teach everyone that failure is just not that big of a deal, as long as we keep trying. This is important for women in STEM, because encountering obstacles and challenging problems is the nature of scientific work. When girls and women believe they have a fixed amount of intelligence and ability, they are more likely to lose confidence and disengage from science and engineering when they inevitably encounter difficulties in their coursework. This is true for all students, but it is particularly relevant for girls in math and science, where negative stereotypes persist about their abilities. And by the way, what Jean Kranz actually said was, when bad things happened, we just calmly laid out the options, and failure was not one of them. But that's a little harder to put on the refrigerator magnet. If you draw an analogy to athletes, athletes have natural ability, but they also train. Nobody will perform at the top of their game if they don't exercise, eat carefully, and practice. It's the same with math. Ability is important and helpful, but I'm afraid it's also overrated. So this is the only formula I'm going to put in my presentation. I borrowed the notion of using only one formula from the late, great Stephen Hawking. When he wrote his book, A Brief History of Time, he was careful to use only one formula. My math and science colleagues, some of whom are my former students, they also notice that this equation is not dimensionally homogeneous. So it really isn't an equation at all. But I chose the figure on this page, the ore digger, for a couple of reasons. First, he really looks like Grit, doesn't he? And second, he is the mascot of my alma mater, the Montana School of Mines. Obviously, Mines is not a charm school. But I mention this because I want to talk for a minute about the Montana School of Mines. The college opened its door in 1900 and graduated its first class in 1904. That first graduation, there were two majors, mining engineering and electrical engineering, and eight graduates. Of the eight graduates, two were women, and one of them was the valedictorian. The School of Mines was always co-ed. Women always studied there with men. And yet, while many women attended over the years, there were no other female graduates until the 1960s. My husband David and I graduated there together in 1986, and now our son Ben is an ore digger studying mechanical engineering. Have you ever driven over Togedy Pass? It's a beautiful road. John and Joanne Enger's daughter Kaya was the lead engineer. She was responsible for the completion of the project. She brought it in on schedule and on budget. So how's that for a Bighorn Basin girl? I especially like this quote because it's by an artist. The field that I most often associate with inspiration and flashes of insight. It's nice to know that hard work is necessary to create art as well. My final picture today is a Facebook post. Geology student Annika Deckard sent her mom a picture of an experiment she's working on. She's simulating the possible origin of life on Earth at the Jet Propulsion Lab. As I scan Facebook in the future, I hope to see many more posts like this. So don't say I'm bad at math, because you're not. Don't accept it from your students or from anybody. Recognize the importance and beauty of math and the endless possibilities unlocked if you try hard and learn. Math ability is not an innate characteristic, but rather is developed through interest, practice, purpose, and hope. Be interested, work hard, and have faith in yourself. And if you encounter an obstacle, maybe say, I'm not good at that kind of math yet. So, do you guys have any questions or comments or things from your personal life? Yes, Mangie.
Well, I understand from my sister Carol, who's a petroleum engineer.
Yes.
Graduated from the University of Wyoming,
yes.
And then the Colorado School of Mines. That she was actually the first woman in the petroleum club in Billings, Montana.
She was. And Jeannie's sister, Carol Edwards, was a great mentor to me. She's only a few years older than me, but when I first went to work, my first job out of college, I went to work at Meridian Oil, and she was the only female engineer at Meridian at that time. And so she had blazed a lot of paths for me. So I will be eternally grateful to Carol for doing that.
And what you had to say is right on. In my family, there was no such thing as you can't do it.
Amen. See, that's a good, you know, the agricultural background is really, I mean, that's one type of background that's just really important, where there's a job to do and
well, actually,
just go
my
do
grandfather
it.
Had an MBA from Dartmouth.
There you
he
go.
He was in the first graduating class in 1991.
That's spectacular.
So education was always valued.
Very good. That's awesome. So see, that's perfect. Yes, ma'am.
What can parents do to encourage young women
right.
to pursue sciences and math?
Yes. Well, there's some really interesting things that are just coming out, and I'll talk a little bit about some new things and some old things. But one of the things that they're learning right now that I'm really getting interested in is historically, men have always tested more, the average man has tested higher in spatial reasoning ability, like putting together Legos, putting together IKEA furniture, just all that sort of thing than women. The average man tests higher than the average woman. And spatial reasoning ability is very important to the study of engineering. So there's a woman at the University of Ohio right now who has done research on teaching not just women, but anybody with lower than they would like spatial skills, to teach them spatial skills before they get into engineering school. And they found out that you only need about 15 hours, not 15 credits, but 15 hours to teach somebody the amount of spatial reasoning that they need to be successful in engineering graphics and AutoCAD. Like I'm looking at some people, there's some very spatial people here, some of my former students, very talented drafters as well as engineers. But so if you just take 15 credits, if you just take, not 15 credits, if you take 15 hours and just teach using Legos, building furniture, and then translating that onto paper, looking at two-dimensional shapes and understanding three-dimensional shapes from a two-dimensional rendering, that your chances of success in college goes way up. I mean, it's really kind of spectacular. So that's one thing you can do with your kids, is give them things to build. And I think if you start like with Legos, even with Legos, Goldilocks, I'm not really a big fan of the whole, I think Legos are Legos, but building anything is a good idea for little kids. And it also, I think, gives them confidence. I think little kids like all of us, we like to achieve something. We like to have something and say, I made this, you know. So it's sort of, there's a bunch of different areas where Legos, building with building furniture. If you're going to put together a piece of furniture, if you have a bookcase that needs to be built, have your kid come help you, you know. Have them find the right tools and have them put things together and show them what a 90-degree angle looks like. And David would probably attest to this. I've built lots of furniture. Some of it I had to have him help me. The last one was a computer desk that was like operating in, I think, 7 dimensions, and I couldn't do it myself. So we had to get down on the floor and do it together, but not really so. But it felt like it when I was trying to do it alone. So anyway, but he came to my aid and we got her done. But also any kind of a like spatial, like when I was growing up, I learned how to sew from a great aunt. And I think just understanding like what a seam allowance looks like, you know, when you take something, you put a seam in it and press the seam and turn it inside out, what it looks like, you know, putting things together so that the sleeve fits into the bodice and so forth. Those sort of things I think are just really important. Another thing that's happening right now, and I'm really interested in learning more about this, but in the original days of computer science, most computer scientists were women. And a lot of the original computer code that was written, such as language COBOL, was written by women. Computer programming came out of the business environment, and so the leaders, the office managers, and people who were women who were working in offices were sort of like the natural lead on computer science. Well, along about 1984, that's the year that's identified as being the change, computers started coming into the home and being used for gaming. And it turned out that young men tended to be more interested in gaming than young women. And so a lot more young men got this incredible advantage of understanding how to work with computers because they were playing games on them. So 1984 is kind of seen as the cutoff of when, prior to that, computer science degrees were awarded pretty equally, and then they became predominantly awarded to men. So what's happening now, a lot of the original computer scientists are retiring, and so there's a big push, and you may know about this even in Wyoming, we have a push to get kids interested in computer programming, and there's a really solid chance of getting young women back involved, because now there's no advantage to having games. Everybody's worked with computers their whole lives. So what I guess I'm saying is prior to 84, women had the advantage because they were working in business. From 84 to about 2004, young men seem to have the advantage, and now everybody's the same again. So right now, like at Northwest College, we just reinstituted our 2-year computer science program to dovetailing with the University of Wyoming's 4 years, and we're about equal in numbers. We have about 15 computer science majors, and I think 6 or 7 of them are women, and 7 or 8 of them are men. So those are some of the things that I think are really important. The other important part of the message, I think, is I think that sometimes young women, like, okay, I'm sorry, I'm going to make a terrible stereotype here, but a lot of young women want to help people, and they want to know what they're going to do is valuable. And I think sometimes it takes a little bit longer for men to get to that point. So you can sell an 18-year-old man on, you can make a lot of money and you can have a boat and a summer home and go on vacation. But, you know, women more often at that age want to think they're going to be able to help somebody. So if you can recognize what it is about engineering that's helpful, I think that could be a factor as well. So, and then also just quit saying you're bad at math. I mean, just stop, because we're not. I mean, everybody, I have several very talented male engineers in this office. Gary and my husband and Christy's husband is not here, but he's here in spirit, right? So, but they're very talented at math, and I don't think any of them would ever say, oh, it's easy. You know, I just went in and it was just like calculus. Yeah, it just made sense to me, right? Or so maybe you did, Gary. I don't know.
No, very much the opposite. What you said was true. Practice is what it takes.
practice, but for some reason, women become discouraged overall. You know, I'm making huge sweeping generalizations here, but often women become discouraged with that, and men seem to have more confidence in themselves or more ability to just keep hammering away at it. So, you know, just, I mean, that's the other part of it, is if you fail, try again. You know, don't take it personally. If you fail, it doesn't mean you're a failure. It just means, well, that didn't work, right? So let's try something else.
I think the way that you talk about sewing as...
Yes.
I think we also traditionally, when we talk about things that women do, like
yes.
sewing and cooking,
right.
we talk about those as things we do to help people, and they are both
True.
Science and math. I mean, there is as much science and math in cooking and sewing as there is in Legos and things that boys traditionally do, too.
Right.
So listening to you makes me think, oh, I never thought about sewing as a
spatial.
Science, math, spatial
mm-hmm.
thing.
Oh, yeah.
To talk to our girls about the things they may have an interest in because their grandmother does it with
right.
them, and to let them see how those things connect to science and math is another way to open a door, in my mind, for sure,
True.
To science and math.
I agree. And just like you're saying with sewing, the other thing is, of course, you have to follow a pattern. You know, you have to, like, line things up with the grain of the material, and you have to, you know, make sure that everything's cut according to the pattern. And I think cooking is another big area. I've actually taught phase changes based on making peanut brittle. And it's not 100% analogy. I have to be really clear. There's some flaws in it, but you can see some things that happen with phase behavior that happen when you cook sugar. And physical changes, really. It's maybe not a chemical change per se, but you definitely get physical changes. So there are a lot of ties into that. And, you know, it's just like sometimes a language, there's some crossovers in the language between cooking and chemistry. There's some crossovers in language between anything spatial, putting together IKEA furniture and building things from a plan, you know? Those are all, yeah, so you're absolutely right, Carol. Yeah.
I think I got through my chemistry labs because I could cook.
See?
And then my lab carried me through my class because reverse logs were
hard. Yes, exactly.
Hard.
Right. Well, and going back again, somebody had asked me, actually my boss, Dr. Gerard at the college, had asked me why I got interested in it in the first place, you know, why I was interested in engineering. And really for me it was chemistry in high school, because I'd always liked math and I'd always kind of messed around with math, but I didn't even know it at the time. I didn't understand what it meant. I just liked puzzles, you know. I just liked like finding things and sorting them out and, you know, putting the right thing over here and making it look a different way. But when I got into chemistry, and they're like, well, if you mix this many grams, that's this many moles, and if you look at the equation, that means you need this many moles of this other thing, and that's how many grams you need. It's like, oh my gosh. You know, it was eye-opening, because it's like math means something in the real world. That was amazing to me. So, yeah, so I think that's, science can be a really, it can form that bridge. You know, I mean, pure math, if you're not a pure mathematician, can be a little out there, you know? But if you, when you see, that's what I think is so cool about engineering. I mean, just, obviously I'm a fan, but, you know, it's just like you bring everything together. There's nothing